Hello and welcome to the Legislative Journal for April of 2024 with State Representative Greg Vitali from the 166th Legislative District representing Delaware County. Rep, good seeing you again.
Ben, good seeing you and thanks for hosting.
Of course. So we'll get right back into the topic of the special election for the 140th Legislative District. Representative Prokopiak now being settled into the House, the majority retained by the Democrats. Get into a little bit about that and how it's been so far after some legislative sessions.
Yeah, that was an important special election because it really determined the majority in the Pennsylvania House. And because Prokopiak won that election, the Democrats maintain their control, and which is important in a number of regards. The majority party designates the majority committee chairs, which from my perspectives mean that I will retain my role as majority environmental and energy committee chair and will control the flow of environmental legislation that's introduced, and also have the ability to choose topics and conduct public hearings on environmental issues. Also, as we approach budget season, it's very important to note that the House Democrats will be drafting the budget document that will become the subject of discussion in the upcoming weeks as we try to finalize our budgets. So, very important election with, at least from my perspective, a good outcome.
And you kind of touched on it a little bit. Before we had all of our legislative sessions, we had the budget appropriations hearings. What was kind of your take on everything that was discussed, and what did you find yourself involved in terms of the appropriations hearings?
Right. So as chairman of the Environmental Resource and Energy Committee, I am invited to give my thoughts and questions with regard to the two administrative apartments, which our committee has oversight over, which is the Department of Environmental Protection and the Department of Conservation and Natural Resources. And I focused my remarks this year on a topic that really has become a chronic topic and something of great concern to me, which is the continued understaffing of the Department of Environmental Protection to the point where they really are not meeting important performance benchmarks. They're not really carrying out their mission. So at the budget hearing I participated in, this is where I focused.
Now let's go ahead and take a look at that clip.
With regard to the governor's budget proposal, I don't think it's done an adequate job of addressing the staffing shortfalls of the DEP, the chronic staffing shortfalls that have existed for many years. Your staff, many of the people who are here today, have been kind enough to spend time with me over the past couple of months explaining some of the problems, staffing shortages, issues that you have, and I'd like to just talk a little bit about that, and then I'll get to my question. The oil and gas program, full complement according to DEP, about a year or two ago was 226 positions. Currently, I'm informed by the oil and gas program, you're down to 171. So you're down 55 positions in the oil and gas program. Your December 2022 report outlined a practice among the conventional drillers of routinely abandoning their conventional gas wells, failing to report production, spreading of roadside brine. A previous, not current, but previous oil and gas program had publicly stated at a meeting that you're failing in your mission. With regard to the clean water program, the I'm told by your program that you only inspect streams. You only have the personnel in your program to inspect Pennsylvania streams once every 30 years. Once every 30 years, when it should be done once every 5 or perhaps every 10 years. There's 27,000 miles of impaired streams in Pennsylvania. I'm told by your staff you need 20 more stream biologists, 20 more, and that has not been provided in this budget. The Bureau of Air Quality, you're down about 99 positions since 2008, and I'm told by your people you're constantly in a panic mode. You have 28 positions in the pipeline, but don't have the money to fund them. You know, you're a previous, not current Bureau of Air Quality, but a previous indicated last year he could use 65 more positions. With regard to the Chesapeake Bay, the Bay received a failing grade in its most recent assessment by the Chesapeake Bay Foundation. It is failing to meet its nitrogen, Pennsylvania is failing to meet its nitrogen reduction goals. Your 2022 water implementation plan indicated a need for 100.5 new positions. And you asked, the Chesapeake Bay program asked for 12 more positions and did not get it. The HASCA program, which includes dealing with PFAS, it said it requested 5 to 6 more positions, which it did not get, and it needs $30 million more to cover costs. You know, I've been working on this issue for many years, and one thing that frustrates me is that I don't think the Department of Environmental Protection or its high-level personnel are being sufficient adequate advocates. You are not being advocates for the agency. When I deal with my leadership, I'm told, well, they're not asking for that, or well, they're not, where are they saying that you need these positions? The DEP is in a deplorable condition. No disrespect to the fine people here. I respect everything you do. But if things are to change, you guys need to be better advocates for yourself.
So, Rep, now that those appropriations hearings are over and done with, what's next in the budget process?
Well, on the particular issue of DEP staffing shortfalls, you know, I have continued to advocate. I've had a personal conversation with Leader Bradford about this issue. But it's my belief that more than the policy arguments, what leadership responds to in crafting the budget is how many members this is an important issue too. It's easily enough to dismiss one member and his strongly held feelings on an issue. So I've been, you know, gathering other legislators who think along my lines. We've been meeting, and our plan next is to sit down with our leadership and make the case that this is an issue which is important to more than one member of our caucus. So we're going to continue our advocacy with regard to this issue and other issues as we move forward. The budget itself, it advances in fits and starts. Probably the starting point from the Democratic caucus perspective is the budget that the governor himself proposed. And it's our job to kind of, you know, tweak that in a way that it's in conformance with our views. So discussions will be held on the budget at a staff level initially, but our current Commonwealth budget, the fiscal year ends the last day in June. So as we approach that date, there will be intensifying efforts to get that budget bill passed by the last day in June.
And the governor doing some work outside of the budget. He recently touted some energy initiatives, PACER and PRESER. Give us your thoughts about that and kind of what they're about, how they're different from energy initiatives that we've been hearing a lot of recently. What's your take on all of that?
Okay, let's start with the PACER program. That is that has been sort of floated as an alternative to REGI. REGI is the Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative. It's an 11-state cap and trade program. It's designed to reduce greenhouse gas emissions in the power generating sector. The way REGI works is that an overall cap of the total greenhouse gas emissions is set and then reduced every year by a certain percentage. I believe it's about 3%. That's done year after year until greenhouse gas goals, reduction goals are made. Credits are created and traded on the open market. They are bought and sold, and you need a credit under REGI to emit greenhouse gases. The REGI was done through administrative action because our legislature is very conservative, and especially in the Senate, would not really address the greenhouse gas issue legislatively. Regulations were passed with regard to Pennsylvania entering REGI, and they were challenged in court on the basis that they constituted a tax, which cannot be done by regulation. I disagree with this assessment. To make a long story short, the PA Supreme Court is still considering whether these REGI regulations were legal or not. My overall assessment of PACER is that the better approach really is just to stay firm on REGI. My hope is that this will not be an excuse not to pursue REGI. PACER, this which is essentially a Pennsylvania only cap and trade program, requires legislative approval, and that's simply not happening in the conservative nature of our Senate. It's just not happening. So PACER kind of is dead on arrival in the Senate as I see it, and the correct approach there with regard to greenhouse gas is to move forward with REGI if we can. On the issue of the PRESS program, which is an alternative way to increase the alternative energy portfolio standard, that we are forced to go the legislative route on that, although we still face the roadblocks of a very conservative Senate. We had considered previously a House bill by Representative Friel Otten, which would have increased the alternative energy portfolio standard 30% by 2030. The alternative energy portfolio standard puts requirements on electric distribution companies like PECO, and it says PECO, under this law, you need to have 8% of the electricity you use and provide to customers come from renewable sources. That's the current law, which falls far short of what other states are doing. The governor's PRESS program essentially starts with that model, but essentially adds a lot more nuance to it. It creates three tiers, and it's essentially requires, just to oversimplify, 35% of energy to come from renewable sources by 2035, and various other energy sources are included in this, and there's the ability to sort of slide from tier to tier. I salute the governor for, you know, giving another shot at expanding the alternative energy portfolio standard. He really doesn't have an administrative alternative to this. So if and when that bill is referred to my committee, then I will give it every due consideration and make an effort to move it out as quickly as we can.
And something that we've been giving a lot of consideration in recent shows is the continued topic of orphaned and abandoned wells. What's the latest on that?
Right. So the Inflation Reduction Act has provided a large pool of money. I think, you know, about over $400 million over the next 10 years to plug these wells. And it's important to plug these wells, you know, because one, they leak methane; two, they can contaminate water supplies; three, they can cause explosions if they gather in buildings, and a number of other reasons. Wells should be properly plugged when they're done use. And the governor has started to use this federal money and has announced recently that he plugs his 200th well. But I think the problem is that as he plugs these wells, there is a greater problem of more wells than he's plugging being abandoned. And I think it's really important to address this abandonment problem as we address the plugging problem. My committee had a hearing on this topic to sort of air that issue out.
Now let's go ahead and take a look at the clip from that hearing.
We have about
So, Rep. Vitali, what is next when it comes to orphaned and abandoned wells in the Commonwealth?
Right. So, you know, I think there's a number of things. I think that the top two that come to my mind, as we had previously mentioned, is bringing the oil and gas program up to full complement. So there's more people, both inspectors out in the field to inspect these wells, and more people in enforcement actions. So when a well is in fact abandoned, there are personnel to engage in the time-consuming process of going after bond money and making conventional drillers do the plugging and so forth. And there's other things too, but I think of these two, So there's the staffing issue, and then there's the bonding issue, increasing the bonding amount. Drillers are less apt to walk away since they've posted a higher bond. I don't think the bonding increase is going to float legislatively. I just think you're not going to get it through conservative Republican Senate. So I think the impetus should be just bringing that oil and gas program up the full complement. So I think that will be our argument as we lobby our leadership as the budget process moves forward. One more reason to focus in on more staffing for the oil and gas program.
And another issue that we've really had our eyes on is the issue of hydrogen hubs. Now that everybody's kind of been under the same roof recently in recent months, has anything updated in the regards to hydrogen hubs?
Yeah, it's a complicated issue. And just by way of background, again, there's a lot of federal money offered for projects throughout the country who take different approaches to the development of hydrogen. And hydrogen is an important fuel to develop because there are just some sectors of our economy that you can't electrify. Ideally, like with cars, for example, you get away from fossil fuels, you convert to electric vehicles, and you generate the electricity used for the vehicles with renewable energy with little greenhouse gas consequence. You can't do that with airplanes. You can't put the batteries on them to make them, you know, fly. They'd be too heavy. And the same is true with long distance trucking, and the same is true with like cement making and steel production. There are just some sectors you can't electrify, and that's where hydrogen comes in. Now, hydrogen has been around a long time and used in numerous applications. The key to hydrogen production is doing it in a carbon-free way. And that is what the federal programs are trying to incentivize. Pennsylvania is part of two groupings of states. In the eastern part of the state, there's the Mach 2 application where Pennsylvania's grouped with other states like New Jersey and Delaware and so forth. And the fuel source they are using or proposed to use with regard to the production of hydrogen is nuclear and renewable energy and renewable natural gas, gas produced from renewable sources like livestock and so forth. In the western part of the state, there's the ARCH2 program that uses where Pennsylvania is hooked up with Ohio and other states. And the goal there is to produce electricity from fossil fuels. Yeah, so we've been trying to learn on the issue. We've had a staff meeting with a committee meeting with the Department of Energy to give us an update. We've actually visited two plants in Newark, Delaware, who would produce electrolyzers, the machines that convert to hydrogen. Learned a lot. So we continue to educate ourselves on the hydrogen issue, and hope that monies being used for hydrogen production will produce hydrogen, which will have a significant impact on climate.
And shifting gears here, upcoming later this month, we have the primary elections, some big races that are coming through to kind of determine who will be the front runners later in November. What are some key races that you are keeping your eye on?
Okay, so primaries, April 23rd, just a reminder, you need to be a member of a major party, Democrat or Republican, to participate, because that's the purpose of primaries. President, U.S. Senate, U.S. House, PA Attorney General, PA Auditor, State Treasurer, State House and State Senate are all on the ballot. A couple of these have contested primaries. I know there's five different candidates in the Democratic Auditor General, Democratic Attorney General race. I think you have a primary in the Republican U.S. Senate race. No primary opponent in the congressional races, no primary opponent in State House race, happily for me. And I believe Amanda Cappelletti, the state senator, is uncontested either. So there are some choices. It's important to vote. And of course, no real primary in the presidential races. So it's important to vote. And and if you're voting by mail, there are three different locations. There's the Haverford Township Administration Building, the Marple Township Public Library, and the Government Center and Media, where you can drop off your completed mail-in ballots.
All righty. And then to wrap up real quick here, what is going on in your district and satellite offices?
Okay, so you know, we're at the corner of Darby and Manoa Roads in Havertown. We have pretty much normal business hours, you know, Monday through Friday, 9 to 5. Friday, we'll close at 4:30. We have a satellite office in at the corner of Lawrence and Sussex Road in Marple, which is for two reasons. One, it's totally handicapped accessible, and it's flat. Everything's flat about it. And also, it's just a way to make things a little more convenient to our Marple constituents. So we welcome our phone numbers, 610-789-3900. And we welcome people at both locations, and we'll do our best to help you with any state-related matter you might have.
All righty, Rep. Thank you so much for yet another Legislative Journal. And folks, thank you so much for tuning in to this April 2024 edition of the Legislative Journal with Representative Greg Vitali from the 166th Legislative District, representing Delaware County.